A three-phase induction motor has 54 stator slots with 8 conductors per slot. A three-phase induction motor has 54 stator slots with 8 conductors per slot and 72 rotor slots with 4 conductors per slot. Find the number of stator and rotor turns. Find the voltage across slip rings at open circuit. Both stator and rotor winding are connected in star with a supply voltage of 440 volts. Okay, a three-phase induction motor has 54 stator slots with 8 conductors per slot and 72 rotor slots with 4 conductors per slot. Find the number of stator and rotor turns. Find the voltage across slip rings at open circuit. Both stator and rotor winding are connected in star with a supply voltage of 440 volts. So for the given statement, the given data is, so stator slots SS is equals to 54, stator conductors per slot ZSS is equals to 8. Don't forget the nomenclature, okay, the notations. Okay, then rotor slots SR is equals to 72 and rotor conductors per slot ZSR is equals to 4. So in the voltage V is 440 volts, supply voltage is 440 volts. I need to find out stator turns, rotor turns and rotor induced EMF. Okay, ER and E slip ring, ESR. ER is per phase voltage and between two slip rings it will be a line voltage. Okay, and here given star connection in stator and rotor both. Okay, so the total number of conductors ZS, stator conductors, is equals to stator slots into conductors per slot. So that is 54 into 8. So these are the total number of conductors. Okay. So this will come out to be, I don't have calculator here. We'll keep it as it is. Then turns per phase is equals to ZS by 6, because ZS is equals to 6 into TS, stator conductors is equals to 6 into TS. This implies TS is equals to ZS by 6, that is 54 into 8 divided by 6. So that will come out to be 72. So number of stator turns per phase is 72. Okay. Similarly, rotor conductors ZR is equals to rotor slots into rotor conductors per slot, SR into ZSR. So that will be 72 slots, okay, into 4. And ZR is equals to 6 into TR. This implies TR is equals to ZR by 6. So 72 into 4 divided by 6. So this will come out to be 48. Okay. So this will come out to be 48. Okay. Then now I got TS, I got TR. From the transformation ratio, okay, from the transformation ratio of induction motor, we have ER by ES is equals to KWR TR by KWS TS. So it is nothing but E2 by E1 equals to N2 by N1. In the transformer, E2 by E1 equals to N2 by N1, where in induction motor, secondary side is always the rotor, primary side is always the stator. Okay, so rotor by stator voltage equals to rotor by stator turns. And in transformer, these winding factors will not come into picture because there is no concept of distributed winding there. Because we may be using distributed winding here, so there comes the winding factors into consideration. So that is KWR is rotor winding factor, KWS is stator winding factor. And generally, we assume rotor winding factor and stator winding factor to be equal. Okay. Let KWR is equals to KWS. Rotor winding factor is equals to stator winding factor. Therefore, ER by ES is equals to TR by TS. All are per phase values. ER is per phase, ES is per phase, TR is per phase, TS is per phase. So all are per phase values. So therefore, ER is equals to ES into TR by TS. But what is ES? ES is supply voltage. But ES is per phase induced EMF in the stator winding. It is per phase induced EMF in the stator winding. So it is taken directly as V divided by root 3. Because the stator is connected in star. Stator is connected in star. Per phase voltage is line voltage by root 3. And this voltage mentioned is always the line voltage. So it is 440 by root 3. This will be 254 volts. Okay. Therefore, ER is equals to 254 into TR is 48 divided by TS is 72. Okay. It is 169.33 volts. So this is the rotor induced EMF per phase at standstill. Okay. Where ER is, this is what? Rotor induced EMF at standstill or rotor induced EMF on open circuit. Because when I say standstill, the rotor may be short circuited, and if the rotor is short circuited, I don't find any voltage across the winding because it becomes zero. Across short circuit, the voltage will become zero. So at standstill, if the rotor is short circuited, my induced voltage will suddenly become zero. Therefore, whenever I want to mention the open circuit, the voltage across voltage in the rotor winding, I will get it only on the open circuit. So, and when in open circuit, induction motor cannot rotate. Okay, when on open circuit, induction motor cannot rotate because with open circuit, there is no current flowing in the rotor, so there is no torque produced in the rotor. Okay, so this is rotor induced EMF on open circuit or rotor induced EMF per phase on open circuit. Okay, now since the rotor is also connected in star, okay. Voltage between slip ring means, now if this is the rotor, now this is the rotor of induction motor, the elevation, and we have the slots. These skewed slots. We don't have parallel slots in induction motor. The slots will be skewed in the rotor. Okay? And each slip ring is connected with each phase. Okay, and it is an open circuit now. Now this is the voltage between slip ring or V slip ring, and that is not ER. Okay, and since the rotor winding is connected in star, the voltage between two slip rings will become line to line voltage. Okay, since rotor winding is connected in star, the voltage between two slip rings is line to line voltage. So therefore, voltage between slip rings or slip ring voltage on open circuit, you can call V slip ring, is equals to, because the rotor is star connected, it will be root 3 into ER, because ER is the per phase voltage induced on open circuit. Okay, so it is root 3 into 169.33, so that will come out to be 293.3 volts. So this is my solution. Okay, so this is how to obtain the slip ring voltage. Okay, here the rotor slots were given, so we could get directly the values. Okay, so we'll move to second example. I will read out the statement. A 90 kilowatt 500 volts 50 hertz 3 phase 8 pole induction motor. A 90 kilowatt 500 volt 50 hertz 3 phase 8 pole induction motor has a star connected stator winding accommodated in 63 slots with 6 conductors per slot. Okay, so there are 63 slots in the stator, and each slot contains 6 conductors. If the slip ring voltage on open circuit is about 400 volts, you please underline about. Okay, why I will tell you later. If the slip ring voltage on open circuit is to be about 400 volts, design the rotor for first one, number of slots, second, conductors per slot, third, coil span, fourth, actual slip ring voltage on open circuit. It means that whatever the slip ring voltage we have been given with, that is an approximate value of slip ring voltage, because slip ring voltage between the two slip rings should not exceed around 400 to 500 volts. Okay, for small medium machines. And for large machines, it will be around 1 kilovolts. Generally, it will be around 1 kilovolts. Okay. So, fourth point, actual slip ring voltage on open circuit. Fifth point, approximate full load rotor current per phase. Sixth, area of conductor if current density is 4.7 ampere per mm square. Okay, area of rotor conductor for current density 4.7 ampere per mm square. Assume efficiency of 85% and power factor of 0.9. Okay, so this is the given statement of the design example. So I will be writing given things on one in one end. Okay, at one corner I will be writing given things. Okay. Yeah, I can use this till the edge. It can be easily recorded. So given things. P out. 90 kilowatts, V 500 volts, F 50 hertz, number of poles equal to 8. Star connected stator, star connected stator, stator slots 63, conductors per slot 6, slip ring voltage, V slip ring nearly 400 volts. Efficiency 85%, cost 5.9. Yeah, what I need to find is rotor slots, rotor conductors per slot. Okay. Third is coil span. Next, actual slip ring voltage, full load current in rotor. Okay, so these are the things I need to find in the given design example. So we'll start with the number of rotor turns. The first given is number of rotor slots. Number of rotor slots. Okay. So first is rotor slots. I think, and also given is area of conductor AZR, okay, when delta is equals to 4.7 ampere per mm square. Well, this was missing. Okay. Yeah. So rotor slots, we have seen in the analytical part that the number of rotor slots per pole per phase should be an integer. Okay, number of rotor slots per pole per phase should be an integer. For full pitched coils, if the fractional slot winding we are using, it should be multiple of pole pairs and number of phases. Okay, so here let us assume, see, our slot per pole per phase should be an integer, should be an integer, therefore slots per pole per phase, let us take it as 3. Okay, slot per pole per phase, let us take it as 3. Okay, so with 3 slots per pole per phase, therefore rotor slots equals to, therefore rotor slots SR is equals to 3 into P into phase, that is 3 into number of poles are 8 into number of phases are 3. Okay, number of poles in stator and rotor will be same. In induction motor, number of rotor poles are generally equal to number of stator poles, so therefore it won't change. So this equals to 3 into 8 into 3, 9 8 is 72, so SR is equals to 72. So rotor number of slots are 72. Next, I should be finding conductors per slot. So to know conductors per slot, first I should be knowing what are the total number of conductors. Okay, to know the total number of conductors, first I should be knowing number of turns per phase. Okay, so second, conductors per slot in rotor. Conductors per slot in rotor. So that SR is equals to, okay, it is ZR divided by SR, and ZR is equals to 6 into TR. Okay, ZR is equals to 6 into TR, that is 3 into 2 TR. Then what is TR? We have TR by ES is equals to KWR TR by KWS TS. Okay, the transformation ratio. Assume KWR is equals to KWS. Therefore, ER by ES is equals to TR by TS, which gives TR is equals to ER by ES into TS. Okay, ER by ES into TS. TS, I can find out. Okay, so TS is equals to, it is SS into ZSS divided by 6. Okay. Total number of slots multiplied by conductor per slot. Total number of conductors in stator. Okay, divided by 6. Number of turns per phase in stator. So is equals to 63 into 6 by 6 is equals to 63. So TS is 63. Then ES. So it is given star connected stator. It is given a star connected stator. Okay. So ES will be V divided by root 3. That is 500 divided by root 3. So this will be, I think, 280, 8.67. Volts. 288.67 volts. Then what about ER? So ER is equals to, it is the voltage per phase. Now, what is the secondary voltage on open circuit? It is the voltage across slip ring. So approximate voltage across slip ring is given as 400 volts. Approximate voltage across slip ring is given as 400 volts. So now I should decide whether the rotor is star connected or delta connected. Once I decide whether the rotor is star connected or delta connected, then I can get ER is equals to, if it is star connected, 400 by root 3. If it is delta connected, equal to 400. But we should be knowing what type of machine we are using. It is the slip ring induction motor. See, nowhere it is mentioned it is slip ring induction motor. Okay. In the problem example or example statement, it is not directly mentioned it is slip ring induction motor, but it is indirectly given voltage across slip ring. Okay, it is voltage across slip ring. It is given, it indicates it is a slip ring induction motor. And when we use slip ring induction motor, generally we connect slip ring induction motor in star because we include the rotor resistance. We include rotor resistance in slip ring induction motor to improve the starting torque. Okay, the reason for using slip ring induction motor is to have better starting torque, and starting torque is directly proportional to rotor resistance square. Okay, so to improve the starting torque, I use a larger rotor resistance. Therefore, I add additional resistance in rotor in the form of star connected external resistance. Hence, generally we use star connected rotor. Okay, so here, for slip ring induction motor, rotor is generally star connected. Therefore, ER is nearly equal to 400 by
root 3, it is 231 volts. Okay, it is 231 volts. Nearly equal to, because it is about 400. I don't know exactly what is the value. In the later part, we will find what is the exact value of rotor slip ring voltage. Okay. So now in this, I know ER, I know ES, I know TS. I can get TR. Therefore, TR is equals to 231 divided by 288.67 multiplied by 63. Therefore, TR is equals to 50.4, nearly 51. Okay.
Generally, we take the next integer, next whole number.
Okay, so nearly equal to 51. Therefore, the rotor conductors is equals to 6 into TR. 2 into TR is the conductors per phase multiplied by 3, that is 3 phase, we will get 6 into TR. So this will be equals to 306. ZR is 306. Therefore, rotor conductor per slot ZSR is equals to ZR by already we have mentioned SR, that is 306 divided by number of rotor slots were I think 72. Okay. So this is equals to 4.25. Okay, I take is equals to 4, because I need conductors per slot should be even so that I can have multiple layer winding. Okay, so generally whether machine is AC or DC, we always choose the conductors per phase to be even in number. Okay, so now ZSR is equals to 4. Now recalculate what are the turns per phase. Okay, so with ZS is equals to ZSR 4, ZR is equals to rotor conductors is equals to 6, not 6, this is conductors per slot, 72 into 4, okay, and number of turns TR is equals to 2 into 4 So this is the second point. Okay, let this be, we'll end here. This is second point. Now what is third point? Third point to be calculated is coil span. Okay, coil span. So we have to look a little bit into what is a coil span. I think now you know what is coil span because you are parallelly learning the electrical drawing, where I think in winding design you know what is already the coil span. Okay, so coil span is what? It is the electrical distance between two coil sides. Okay, now if this is one conductor and this is second conductor, now the distance between this is coil span. And this coil span can be mentioned in terms of angle, in terms of distance physically, in terms of number of slots. Okay, so here I don't know what is distance. Okay, I don't know what is the diameter of machine and I don't know what is length and all those things. So I don't know what is the distance. Angle of coil span, okay, depends whether I choose a full pitch coil or a fractional pitch coil. If I choose full pitch coil, For full pitch coil, coil span is 180 degrees electrical. It is electrical angle. 180 degrees electrical. So that my each coil side will be exactly at the same position but in opposite poles. My coil sides will be exactly at the same position but under opposite poles. So coil span will be exactly 180 degrees. For fractional pitch coil, for fractional pitch, coil span is less than 180 degrees electrical. It cannot be more than 180 degrees. Okay, and the maximum coil span electrical angle is 180 degrees. Okay, because one half cycle is of 180 degrees. That is the reason. So now, for fractional pitch, coil span is less than 180 degrees. Now here it is nothing mentioned about whether we should go for coil span, sorry, fractional pitch or full pitch. But while considering number of slots per pole per phase, okay, to be an integer, we assumed full pitch. Because if it was fractional pitch coil or fractional slot winding, then the number of rotor slots I would have taken equal to the multiple of pole pairs and equal to the multiple of phases. But here I took directly the number of slots per pole per phase to be an integer, so it indicates I am using the full pitched coil. So when I use full pitched coil, my coil span is 180 degrees. But this is not sufficient for me to just design the winding, because coil span equal to 180 degrees is for every machine, whether AC, DC, alternator or motor. It is by default. Now here I have the number of rotor slots into my hand, in my hand. So I can mention the coil span in terms of number of slots. Okay. So coil span I will mention here in terms of number of slots. Here we mention coil span in terms of number of rotor slots. In terms of number of rotor slots. Okay, then by assuming, full pitch coils. By assuming full pitch coils, then coil span will be equal to slots per pole. Then coil span will be equal to slots per pole. Okay, so why slots per pole? Suppose this is under one pole, this is under second pole. So this under north pole, this under south pole. So there are so many number of slots. Now, if this is one coil side of the coil, then for a full pitched winding or full pitched coil, the other coil side will be here. That is called full pitch winding. See, it is at the start of north pole, it is at the start of south pole. So both the coil sides are at the same position under the pole, but the poles are in opposite polarity. So this is full pitch coil. So this is one coil span. This is a coil span. Then how many number of slots? The second coil side is far away by how many number of slots? Number of slots equal to that those are falling in one pole, that is slots per pole. So this is equals to number of slots in rotor are 72 divided by number of poles are 8. So this is equals to 9. So coil span equals to 9 slots. Coil span equals to 9 slots. Next, fourth point is actual slip ring voltage. Okay, is actual slip ring voltage. So VSR is equals to root 3 into ER.
But ER is already been calculated with VSR equal to 400 volts. But that is just an assumption. Now with available number of conductors per slot, I will recalculate what are the turns per phase in rotor and get back the induced EMF per phase in the rotor. Okay, with ZSR equals to 4 with rotor conductor per slot, ZSR is equals to 4, ZR is equals to SR into ZSR, number of rotor slots multiplied by conductors per slot. This will be 72 multiplied by 4, it will be 288. It is 288. So ZR is 288. Therefore, TR is ZR by 6. That is 288 by 6. So TR is equals to 48. So these are the, this is the new value of turns per phase. With old value of voltage, I got TR is equals to 51. Okay. So with that, their number of conductors were 306. But number of conductors now are 288, therefore turns per phase are 48. Okay. Therefore, actual ER is equals to. Okay. Therefore, ER by ES is equals to TR by TS. Already we have assumed KWR equal to KWS. I will not again mention it here. So this gives ER is equals to ES into TR by TS. ES is constant, ES will not change because it is the supply voltage. It is 500 by root 3, it is constant. Therefore ER is equals to 288.67 multiplied by TR is 48 divided by TS was 63. Okay. TS was 63, yeah, it was 63. Therefore, ER is equals to 220 volts. You will get around 219.9 or something or 8 something. It is 220 volts. So the actual voltage per phase in the rotor on open circuit is 220 volts. Therefore, slip ring voltage on open circuit, therefore actual slip ring voltage on open circuit, that is VSR, is equals to root 3 into ER. ER is per phase, rotor is star connected, therefore multiply root 3 to obtain the line voltage. Equals to root 3 into 220, I will get around 381 volts. So this is the actual value of rotor voltage between the slip rings on open circuit. Okay. Next point. VSR is over current rotor current at full load. Okay. Rotor current per phase at full load. See, rotor current per phase or line, both are same because rotor is star connected. Okay. So once I get rotor current, it is per phase current only. Okay. Whatever I calculate is per phase current. So next point number 5. Rotor current per phase on full load, or full load rotor current on per phase. Okay. We will have one assumption here. Since cos phi is equals to 0.9,
since cos phi is equals to 0.9. Rotor ampere turns, since cos phi is equals to 0.9, rotor ampere turns per phase is equals to 0.9 stator ampere turns per phase. We have taken in the analysis as 0.85, assuming cos phi 0.85. So here, if you want to assume the rotor MMF per phase, it should be cos phi times the stator MMF per phase. Okay. What is rotor ampere turns per phase? It is IR into TR is equals to 0.9 IS into TS. IR into TR is equals to 0.9 IS into TS. I know what is TR, I know what is TS. Now I should be knowing what is IS. That is the line current per phase. Okay, stator line current per phase. So IS is equals to, okay, or generally Q is equals to 3 into IS into ES into IS KVA. Okay, 3 ES IS into KVA. Or therefore IS is equals to Q into 10 to the power 3 divided by 3 into ES. Okay. ES is per phase voltage, IS is per phase current. So ES into IS is per phase volt amperes multiplied by 3 phase volt amperes. Because power is a scalar, it has to be added from all the three phases. Now what is Q? Therefore Q is equals to I have P out divided by efficiency into power factor. So P out is 90K divided by 0.85 into 0.9. Efficiency is 0.85, that is 85%. Cos phi is 0.9. Therefore the KVA rating of the induction motor Q is equals to 117.647 kVA. Therefore IS is equals to 117.647 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 3 into ES. ES was 500 by root 3, so that was 288.67. therefore IS will be equals to 135.84. okay, I will take 136 amps. 135.84, I will take nearly 136 amperes. Okay, now in this relation I know TR, I know IS, I know TS. Then I can get IR is equals to, therefore IR is equals to 0.9 IS TS divided by TR. 0.9 IS TS divided by TR. So IR is equals to 0.9 into IS is 136 into TS is 63 divided by TR is 48. Therefore IR is equals to, okay, around 161 amperes. IR is 161 amperes. So this is full load rotor current per phase. Full load rotor current per phase. Next, area of rotor conductor. Area of rotor conductor is at R is equals to IR divided by delta R. Okay, so delta R given is 4.7 ampere per mm square. IR is 161 divided by 4.7. Okay. AZR is equals to, you will get around 34 point some 3 or mm square. I don't know exactly how much because I have approximated the current to 136 amperes. Okay? It won't change much. Some 34 point some mm square. So this is the rotor conductor size. Okay, so definitely I should be using the rectangular conductors. I can't go for round conductors or wires here since the area has crossed 10 mm square. So I should be getting the rectangular conductors into the slot. So conductors per slot are 4. Okay, there are 4 conductors per slot. So this is the solution for the rotor design example, that the statement that I have passed on to you. So in the next class we will start with the design of squirrel cage rotor. Okay, so this was the design of slip ring rotor. So next we will start with the design of squirrel cage rotor. Okay. So we'll end here. So on Monday's class, we'll start with the design of squirrel cage rotor. Okay. So thank you.